University of Pittsburgh. He will speak on conduct sets, order topology, and mirrors. Paul?
Well, first of all, it's fantastic to be here. I see you have a beautiful new building, which doesn't even appear on Google Maps. It's a great pleasure to be here, and I'm going to move straight on to my talk. So, yep, compact sets, order, topology, and mirrors. So this is the basic setup in which we're going to work today. Let me start by saying, and this may disappoint some of you and cheer others of you up, that when I say space today, with all of the time I mean a separable metric space, unless I say otherwise. Okay, what else? The basic problem that I'm looking at here is relating together three different objects of three different types. And so we're going to look at the set of all compact subsets of my separable metric space X, that's K of X. And what I want to do is I want to relate these three objects. So the first object is the space X. The second object is K of X, so all compact subsets, or considered as an ordered set. And the third object is K of X as a topological space, a hyperspace. And in particular, I'm interested in three-way equivalences, ways that we can connect all three of these together at the same time. And I will show you two easy examples and one interesting example of how we can relate these three together. And the main result of the talk will be another way that we can relate the three together. And before I do that, I need to say a little bit about what the heck I'm talking about. Always good to know what we're talking about. So, what do I mean when I'm talking about K of X as an ordered set? Well, we can order it by setting food. And I could just consider K of X as an ordered set and consider equivalence to be isomorphism of partially ordered sets. But that doesn't turn out to be a good thing to do. It's too fine. So a better way in our context is to consider what happens to our compact sets co-finally. So slightly tongue-in-cheek, the way I phrase this is that I'm going to split up the problem of understanding topological spaces into two parts. So if you're a continuum theorist, then your job is to deal with the compact bits, right? Compact and connected bits. You have the great topology, you have to do the compact bits. So the next thing we would like to know is how do the compact bits inside of the space fit together? Right? If we understand those two pieces of information, then we understand a lot about how the space operates. And so what we need to know is we don't really need to know what the little compact sets are, we need to know how the compact sets fill out the space. So we need to understand Alright, so there's a way to do this. There's a standard way that we can look at directed sets after cofinality. It's called the 2P order, and I've given a somewhat simplified picture of it here. P and Q are directed sets, think K of X, and we want to say that P is bigger than Q. And the way we do this is that we say that there needs to be a map from the first to the second, P to Q. It needs to be order preserving, and it needs to have the property that the image is cofinal. Right? So since we're doing things cofinally, P knows enough about to understand the preserving. Okay, now this is a slight cheat. My definition here. It works in the context that we're looking at, and it's easier when we're looking at KLX. Also, for basic background, some directed sets that we're going to use. One omega, so 0, 1, 2, counting along. Omega is the omega, so whenever we do powers or products, we're going to do the order coordinate wise. So this is omega going up, and then we take function. So if one is above the other, if the function graph lies one above the other, all the way across. Omega, that you get to do a lot of work in set theoretic topology. So here it's acting as a directed set, as an ordered set. It's also a countable discrete space. So at other times when I write omega q omega, if I'm thinking topologically, this is actually the irrational, right? The natural numbers, countable power, actually the irrational. Okay, so that's a k of x as an ordered set. The other k of x piece of the puzzle is that it's a topological space. And in general, we can give K of X a nice reasonable topology by giving it the Via Torus topology. Today, we're talking mostly about separable metric spaces. And so in this case, there's a very simple way of explaining what the metric is on K of X. And really, the idea is that we want to define this U metric, the Hausdorff metric, from you want to say when things are epsilon close. And so the natural thing is that if you have k and you draw around it an epsilon entourage, then your other compact set, the L to be epsilon close, has to be inside of that epsilon entourage. Metrics are symmetric, so you also have it round the other way. So k is inside of the epsilon entourage around L. And that's exactly what this says here. And it actually defines the metric. And okay, the normal way I say this is that if you imagine in your head some sequence of compact figures converging visually to another compact figure, that's what the Via Torus topology of the Hausdorff metric is. Right? The natural thing is what they do. All right, and it's also going to be very important to us that if we take points in X and we send them to their singleton, this is a closed copy of X inside of K of X. Yes, closed copy of X sits inside of K of X through the singletons. Okay, and so the problem set up was that we were going to try to connect together these three things, space X, K of X directed up to the 2Q order, and K of X as a topological space. And here are two trivial examples of exactly that, right? So here we have that X is compact. What does that mean? It means that when we look at the compact subsets of X, there's the biggest one, right? X itself. And so that's the thing at the top that corresponds to 1. And it's important but very old theorem that the hyperspace of all compact subsets and the compact space is itself compact. So we have our three-way equivalence. And life is good. Okay, the second line actually says when X is locally compact, this is the same as K of X being locally compact. This is pretty straightforward. In fact, follows from the previous line, essentially. When you look down from some particular compact neighborhood. The one which will be a little bit less familiar to you is this one in the middle, that omega controls the compact subset of X. And the way to think about this, the way to see this, is to notice that, again, we're working in separable metric spaces, actually, the first countable D3 will be fine here. And in first countable regular spaces, being locally compact is actually the same as being hemi. Any compact means that there's a countable co-final family compact sets, and that is essentially what this says, a countable family compact sets we control it. So once we've moved to thinking of hemi-compact rather than locally compact, the middle line is also clear. Okay, so these are trivial, but they just help us set the scene. And these are the kinds of three ways of equivalences that we're looking for. That's the interesting one, is this one. This one's Judith Christensen. And it's one of my favorite theorems in the last few years, anyway. So again, I have separable metric X. And the topological property on X is that it is poly. And this just means that it has a metric which is complete Cauchy sequences. It can section. And it's pretty easy to see that if we take the given complete metric on X, then the Hausdorff metric itself is complete. And so K of X is Polish. And it's also pretty obvious that if K of X is Polish, I told you that X embeds inside of K of X as a Polish subset. So just a trace down of a complete metric on K of X on X would be a complete metric. So those two are equivalent. And the interesting one is the one in the middle. The one in the middle talks about the order. Right. So being Polish means there exists this metric which does something very precise. The one in the middle says just that the compact subsets of X are arranged in a particular pattern. If they feel very different, one tells you that stuff happens because you think it's different. And the other one just says we have a certain shape of the compact set. So that's what it says. If the compact subsets of X are Tukey quotiented by omega to omega, then we have it. Actually, add something there, which is that if I take omega to omega, and now I think of it as a space, so this is the irrationals, and I take its space of compact subsets, and this is actually the same as omega. So a slightly different way of thinking about this is, say, I take your favorite standard Polish space, which is not too trivial, for example, the irrational. Look at its compact subsets and any other separable metric space which is no more complicated than it in terms of the compact subsets. All right, so this is Christensen's rather lovely theorem. It ties together the three things I'm interested in. And it's the place where we start. Let me also remind you that space is Polish, means that it's a G delta subset of every compactification which it sets, or equivalently of some compactification which it sets. And of course, I'm counting Polish, so Cantor sets, just leave those two facts that I have said. Okay, now one of the reasons why we like Polish spaces in general, for example when we do balanced spaces, things like that, is that not only do we have Cauchy sequences conversion, but we also have the bare pattern. This is a standard way in which we prove that things exist. And I've written it down in the void, although I'm sure you've seen it and probably thought it many, many times. So what does it say? In a Polish space, we know that if we take a countable intersection of open dense sets, then the intersection is dense. All right. In classical topologist style, we're going to consider this as a definition. Okay, so we call a space a bare space, and it means that it satisfies a conclusion. The intersection of countable family of open dense sets is dense. All right, now, when I was talking about K of X being Polish, implying X being Polish, I pointed out that X is a closed subset, and so the complete metric on this big space is inherited to the closed subspace. Therefore, whenever you have a Polish space, not only is it itself bare, but so are all of its closed subsets. So we make that into a definition as well. And so a space is hereditarily bare, if and only if every closed subspace is bare. Hereditarily bare is a nice property. It does things that we like to do, it has nice theorems about it. And one that I particularly like, and one that I find particularly useful, is that there's a nice check to see when a space is hereditarily bare. Again, when you're teaching your topology courses and you tell them about the bare attribute theorem, you want to give them an example of a simple metric space which is not, doesn't satisfy the bare attribute theorem, and the one this is a canonical example for rationals of a non-hereditary bad. That something is hereditarily bad, all you need to do is you need to go look at its closed subspaces. If one of them is the rational, it's not hereditarily bad, but if none of them are, then it is. Okay, so this gives a good way of checking the space of hereditarily bad. Again, when I say space normally in this talk, it means sensible metric, but in fact, that's countable in T3 is all that's needed to make this one work. Okay, and and this is the actual problem for today. So if we think that Christensen's theorem was about how can we detect when a space X is Polish using its compact subsets topology of order. So our task today is to work out when is K of X. Do this, and there are like three possible solutions that I can think of straight away, right? So one of them would be, we know that if X is Polish, then K of X is Polish, and hence hereditary bad, so that's a positive solution. So one outcome is this is the only way it can happen, right? The only way that K of X is hereditary bad is actually when it's Polish. And well, the answer to that is no, and there were a number of consistent counterexamples. So I think the weakest that I know of is with D equals C. previous best. Okay, and says it right. Yeah, I'm going to show you actually, in fact, there are CFC examples. The set theory was not necessary, but even more importantly, I'm going to explain exactly what that is for this. The property which characterizes it, which is in its own right an interesting. Okay, so this is possible solution number one. K of X is hereditarily bare only when it's Polish. That's not true, at least consistently. The other extreme would be we know that if X is Polish, K of X is Polish. What about if X is hereditarily bare and K of X is hereditarily bare? That's the next natural one. So good to have an example of a space which is hereditarily bare or not Polish. Well, here's one, Bernstein sets. I expect everyone to know those as well. Standard transfinite construction. And what we do is we end up with a dense subset of compact metric space, closed with interval, so that every Cantor set meets the set of the Hertz complement. Let's notice that this means that both B and its complement are countable. And then B is hereditarily bare. And I'm just going to sketch the argument for you because it demonstrates some of the ideas that we have. So if I have the closed unit interval and I have a dense set inside of it, it's really difficult to draw this in any sensible way. It's just a bunch of dots. So you have to imagine it. As a set theoretic topologist, if you want to draw pictures, you have to. I think continuous theorists are way better. So here we go. What are we looking at? What we're looking at is this blob here is actually the closed unit interval. B is on the left, and the complement is on the right. So obviously, the vision B in red, but anyway, it's a program. And so what we want to say is let's suppose that we have a Q, which is a closed subset. B, and let's suppose that this looks like the rationals. Close copy of the rationals sitting inside of the space. We want to show that this can't happen, right? That this can't be a closed subset. So what do? Well, we just close off. We take the closure inside of the big space, inside of I. This. And now the whole of this is going to decompact. And in particular, we can now reflect. We can move out of B, and we can look into its reflection over here on minus B. And we can look at what's left over. And what we have is that we have a compact set minus minus the rationals. Okay? So it's Polish. And also because the rationals are dense in this compact set, this part here doesn't have any isolated points. So it has to be uncountable. And uncountable Polish spaces always contain countable sets. That's one of the facts that I mentioned. But the whole point of Bernstein sets is that you don't have countable sets either on the left or the right side. Okay. So it's not there. Just drew an impossible picture. We don't find a closed copy of the rationals in a Bernstein set. And the way we did it is we looked inside of a bigger space and we reflected into another part of the work. Okay. One other reason why I showed you this is that this is an example where, in fact, the space of compact subsets of a Bernstein set it's not hereditary there at all. Bears very badly. It's a Campbell union of those nowadays. So no bear category for you. All right. So what we're looking for still is this three-way equivalence. So what we're trying to do is we want to fill in the question marks in each of these. And we can. And this was work which I did, first part of it, Mammoth Flesh Feeling, just now in Melbourne, and the other half was with Andreas Bernini and Lubomir Stomsky, who are in Vienna. Okay. Now, my personal interest recently has been very much on the order structure side of things. I'm interested in the two-key order. For today, I actually want to focus more on the topology side. So the two-key part will be the smaller player, even though it's actually my favorite part. Okay, so that means that I'm going to just take this one and move on reasonably quickly. So this is work with Anna. And so we showed that the K of X is not hereditarily there. Precisely when its space of compact subsets does not lie above that. So I can draw a little picture over here. So here is the ordered set 1. It corresponds to when X is compact. We know that omega corresponds to X and K of X being locally compact. What we know here is that this is omega to the omega. And all of the Polish spaces are down here. That's what Christensen's theorem says. If the compact sets are controlled by omega to omega, then you're Polish. Over here is KQ. The compact sets of the irrational. And the things which are not hereditarily there are the ones which are in this region here. So they lie above. They lie above. In other words, the ones I'm actually interested in are in the gap here. So these are the K of X's which are potentially hereditarily there. Just because I draw a picture and there's a big gap in it doesn't actually mean there's anything in there. It's just there it is. Okay, so what we're interested in is what goes into the gap. Okay. So, what is it we want to do? We're looking for this CSC example of this nice space where K of X is hereditarily there, but X and K of X are not Polish. So, the natural thing to think about here is to think, well, we need to somehow improve that Bernstein set. We need to make it not just hereditarily there, but really strongly hereditarily there. And and the reason I went to see Andrea and Lubomir was because at the point when I contacted them, they'd just written a paper about strong versions of hereditary bare spaces. And they gave them wonderful names like Miller space, and countably controlled, countable Bendixson. So my plan was I'd go off to Vienna, which seemed like a good plan in itself, and then I would hang out with Lynn and Andreas, they would help me check whether these particular strongly hereditarily bare spaces were of that type, which I wanted, and that didn't work. It doesn't work. That didn't work at all. However, it turns out that Lubomir has various other interests, and it turned out that one of these other interests, which seemed completely irrelevant, was actually what we needed. So the way that we do it is that we change the point of emphasis. Instead of thinking that we need to upgrade Bernstein's set somehow to be strongly hereditarily there, we might aim instead to be almost Polish. We know that Polish works, so let's try to be almost Polish. And that's kind of what this diagram says. So what we're going to do is we're going to start with our separable metric space, like B, the Bernstein set. We put it inside of a metric compactification, like the closed unit interval for the Bernstein set. And we put its remainder, what we call X-check. And this is our mirror, right? It's just like in the picture over there. We have this mirror. Space compactification and its remainder. And we know that X is Polish. It means that it's the G delta inside of this matrix. That's what it means to be Polish. And if we flip the mirror over, we become what's on the other side. It means that X check, the complement, is an F sigma, Kalman union of closed sets, which inside a compact space means, in fact, that X check is sigma. So instead of trying to look for a nearly Polish space, we're going to look in the mirror and we're going to look for spaces which are nearly sigma. And then we reflect back the other way and that will hopefully give us what we want. Okay. And the thing we want is things called Menger sets. So I'm going to probably rather butcher the history here, but Gurevich and Menger were interested in trying to find characterizations of sigma compact spaces using open covers. Okay? And so Menger came up, I think, with this one. That's the way to do it. So what you might think is that we take a sequence of open covers, and what we need to then be able to do is, for each one of them, we could pick a finite subsection so that that countable union is a finite subsection of colors. Okay, so imagine you have your sigma compact space with the compact sets growing out. You can find from the first open cover, you can find a finite subcollection covering the first compact set. The second collection, you can find a finite subcollection covering the second compact set, and so on. And collectively, all of those finite subcollections will do what's needed. Okay, so that's Menger. Gurevich actually came rather thought that this wouldn't work. He was correct. He came up with a stronger version, with a stronger property on the selection, which also didn't work, but that's another story. The one that we want. Okay, so, for every sequence of open covers, there are these finite selections. Sigma compact implies Menger, and obviously Menger implies Dirichlet. Right? You take the same open cover of all of the units. Also, just for future reference, let me point out that if we change the families of open covers, then we can insist on a better selection. So let's suppose that we only look at open covers which are closed under finite units. And instead of having to take a finite subcollection from these guys, you can just pick out one. Right? And this will work. So, more restrictive family, but a nicer selection. Just simple. Okay, just want to refer to that because I will glance and mention it later. Alright, and the great thing about main sets, at least from our point of view, I'm going to look for interesting examples. Yes, they actually exist in VFC. They're real things. And the original construction was due to Fremden and Miller. This was one of those slightly quirky, dichotomous constructions. They did it first under D equals D, and then D equals S and D, and together it all worked. Slightly more hands-on and direct one. Construction was made by Bartoszynski and Sarban. I've actually written out here, just to show you the idea. The basic idea is that it's a fence finite construction like D of infinite subsets of natural numbers. We think of the infinite natural numbers, or all natural subsets of natural numbers, as being the Cantor set, standard way. And so it picks up its topology, and okay, you do this, and it works. So they really exist. Okay, now again, the point is that we're trying to work with mirrors. So the mega set per se is not what I'm interested in. What I'm interested in is the copies. So the co-mega sets are what happens when you have a remainder which is mega. Now you need to be a little bit careful here because SpaceX will probably have many metric compactifications, and it just turns out very conveniently that if one remainder is mega, then they all are. It doesn't matter which compactification you work in, you will always find that the remainder is going to be mega. And the theorem is the one that we want. Okay? It says that when you're actually co-mega, almost polish, because you're a complement of an almost signal compact set, K of x is actually inherited back. In fact, it's co-mega, which is a stronger property. That's what class 2 says. And what time am I finishing again?
We have like 20 minutes.
Okay. Not too much time. So the basic idea is actually essentially what happens in the diagram over there. We've got a few more. Those properties are actual. Complement, you look to see what happens with the memory space that happens. It rules out the possibility. Same thing. Just a couple of pointers on the proof. Well, one thing here is again the fact that it doesn't matter which remainder we take. So when I'm trying to show that K of x is co-mega, I know that gamma x is. So K of gamma of x is compact. So I can look for the complement inside of K of gamma of x. So it's very concrete, I can actually see it. And so then you go and show that if x check is mega, then the complement of K x and K gamma of x is also mega. And you do it mapping things around. Really sensible things. We're looking for a three-way equivalence. We have three points. We've got two arrows. We only need one more arrow. And here it is. So the final part of the proof is to show this is actually the contrapositive. If K of X is hereditarily bare, then X is in fact co-mega. So the proof shows, as I said, the contrapositive. You imagine that X is not co-mega. So there is some sequence of open covers that is no way to select finite. Cover, and then you have to prove that K of X is not hereditarily there. And I'll say just a few words about the proof. And then we get our theorem. We get our three-way equivalence. When is it true that K of X is hereditarily bare? It's precisely when X is co-mega. Quotient the compact subsets of X onto the compact subsets of the rationals, which are the standard non-hereditarily bare space. Alright, so to finish up, I'm just going to talk a little bit about some consequences and corollaries and questions related to this. So I'll talk about a little bit about products. Talk about consonant spaces, and I know some people in the audience will like this, and we're going to talk about games as well. And just to cover the basis, we'll have a little application to CP theory. Also, part of the reason is that I sneak in three open problems, which I like. So this way you go, you've got it too. Okay, so, the first the first corollary is to do with products. So Polish says that there exists a metric which does something. There is something which does something. And quite often when you say there exists something, then unexpected nice things will also happen. On the other hand, the definition of things like compact or menge say for all something, something happens. They say that something, some property occurs, but they don't really rule anything out. In those circumstances, as a theoretical topologist, your first instinct will be that if anything can go wrong, it will go wrong. Right? This is true. And it's true here for a bear. It's obviously nice under subspaces, nice in other ways, but for products, it's strangely badly behaved. The countable product proposed, they have proposed. Product of a square of a hereditary bear space. You could have the 100th power being hereditary bear and 101st not. And you can also have it so that all of the final powers are hereditary bear, but the countable powers. Now, when we're looking at K of X, then in fact we know a little bit more. Remember that x embeds inside of k of x. You just take the point and you put it to the singleton. It's almost true that x squared embeds inside of k of x as a closed set. You take your pair, xy, and you make the double to the xy. But of course, xy and y of x will go to the same place. That's not quite right. But it doesn't really matter. It's pretty easy to see that if k of x is hereditary pair, then these less than or equal to n element subsets which are closed, and you can deduce that the nth power of x is just hereditary. Right? So knowing that k of x is hereditary pair already gives you something to tell you the finite power of x. But what you don't have is you don't have a closed copy of the countable power of x. Not canonically, not natural. So it just so happens that omega is easily seen to be. And that tells us that when k of xn is hereditary bare, it's actually co-menial. So this product is also co-menial and it's hereditary bare. In particular, if you take one space x and you look at k of x and you know that it's hereditary bare, then x to the omega, the countable power of x, is also hereditary bare. So when Andrea suggested that maybe the converse was true, k of x is hereditary bare, wrote back and said this, and I didn't actually say it in the email, which is good in hindsight, but my implication was, well, it's not very likely, is it, because we actually get this. I still can't see how to prove this directly without knowing this. Okay, so that's the first one. Next one I want to talk about consonants, actually. I want to do it by a short discussion of a different proof. So after we came up with our proof, which involves, it starts with your arbitrary separable metric x. So the first step is we do some 2D stuff, which means that we can actually just work inside of the Cantor set, which makes things much more combinatorial. And then we do some combinatorics, and we do a little bit of descriptive set theory. It's all separable metric based and a little bit zigzaggy. I quite like it, but it's a little zigzaggy. So I presented this in the seminar at Pitt. A short while later, Nikolai wrote and told me, yes, he didn't actually say it this way, but he meant that I have a better way of doing it. I have a better way of doing it. And he has an alternative proof using a strong shock. One of the nice things about this proof is that it's pretty easy to see it works not just for separable metric spaces, but in a lot of generality. And I also checked that our other half of the theorem works as well, not just what we're talking about. So we have an equivalence of the two topological parts of the theorem in much broader classes. as soon as you have a metric space of uncountable weight, so it's not a separable metric, then almost always the space of a set of compact subsets is equivalent to the one with the space along with the rational. And this is, of course, not for a very depth of a close pocket of the rational. And this X is arbitrary. So you can't tell them apart using the order structure in general in the system. The order part only works. Okay, so I'm going to skip over the game part of that and move on to consonants. Consonants. I could have written down the definition for you, but then we would all be equally confused. So I didn't. It's important, but it's technical. And the reason why I'm interested is that Boutier showed that if we have a set of metric consonant space, showed that there is consistently a separable metric consonant space, which is not Polish, which was a consistent counterexample to this problem. Bertha and Shapotov who introduced it. That's right. Okay, so I've cheated by not telling you what consonants is, but I've told you what's important, which is that it's really a pair that's been hereditarily bare. And now I'm going to show you the game version and actually give a definition. So topological games are fun. The game which we're interested in here is we have a space X. We have some collection of open covers, and we have this game. And the game has countable infinity of steps. There are two players. First player picks an open cover. Second player picks an element of the open cover. And the second player wins if their selections cover the whole space. And it's a classical theorem that in fact being Menger is the same as player one not having a winning strategy. In the game that we play where we look at open covers which are closed under the finite universe. Another classical property is the Rothberg property, so this is the strengthening of Menger. And the difference is that we play the game but we allow arbitrary open covers. At the last spring topology conference, Francis Jordan was there, and he basically what he showed was that if we define a new thing, which I call Jordan, and it means that player one doesn't have a winning strategy in this game is where we play with open covers which are K covers, every compact set containing an element. So if we say that a space is Jordan, player one doesn't have a winning strategy, then being consonant is the same as being co-Jordan in my sense, right? They're reflective. So since we have a theorem which says that if X is co-Menger, then we know that K of X is hereditarily pair, and we know that Jordan implies Menger, this automatically tells us or gives us Boutier's theorem. If you're consonant, your space compact sets. Now we're going to go down the rabbit hole at this point, so I'm going to step back just a little bit, but I'll say this quickly. So we have a consistent example of space which is Menger, but not Jordan, and hence one which is K of X is hereditarily pair, but not constant. We also know of many more consistent examples distinguishing these properties. This is quite tantalizing because in the labor model, there are no Rothberg sets, right? These guys exist in ZFC, these ones consistently don't exist. So another option might be that it's consistent that there are no constant non-Polish spaces. Don't know about that, but what we do know is that we know in the labor model there are, in fact, examples of Jordan sets. So the forcing construction that we have doesn't. I still think that there's probably a ZFC counting problem. But again, we have results which say this is hard, that there are various restrictions on what we have. Okay. also mentioned finally, let's have an application for CP. So CP of X is just the order continuous real value function on space X, point-wise topology. You might wonder when two spaces have linearly homeomorphic CPs. We say X and Y are equivalent in this case. It turns out that if X and Y are L equivalents, so they have these homeomorphic function spaces, if K of X is hereditary bare, and so is K of Y, actually transferred over. This is a favorite game that we play at CP theory. I won't go through the proof, but the key point is that it relies on the middle line. It relies on the ordered theoretic part. So when CP of X and CP of Y are linear homeomorphic, it actually means that the same sets with the compact tokens are linear homeomorphic. The neighborhood filter of zero in CK of X is very closely connected to the compact subset of X. It's the compact open body that the body comes from compact. So that makes sense. And being hereditary bare means that the K of X doesn't lie above K of Q. So you just chase around the diagram and you automatically get that K of Y doesn't lie above K of Y is hereditary bare. Okay. Wanted to show you this just to show that the order part is also useful, but also so I could remind you of this question of Hopkins, which is a very interesting one. So that was about K of X. If K of X is hereditary there, then Y is hereditary there. What about just X and Y? So this is a very fun problem. All of the standard techniques for constructing counterexamples will fail for this. It's definitely something we don't know how to do. And my last open problem is to stop putting the word hereditarily in front of everything. So we just have hereditarily. When is it true that K of X is just bare? Now, if a space has a dense set of isolated points, it's bare for non-interesting reasons. So it's probably useful just to look at separate metric without isolated points. And I actually have a conjecture. We think that this is the one which will work. The really bizarre thing about this is that McCoy, many, many, many years ago, showed that the space of all closed subsets of a separable metric space is bare, slicing when X is bare. This space is it's non-metrizable and is strange and weird, but we know the answer. K of X is a nice little separable metric space, and we don't. That's a little odd. Okay, and so just to finish off, this is kind of directed to graduate students or postdoc in the audience who are thinking, what should I take from this book? What's actually useful? What can I think about? And one of them is that I think that this interplay between a space X and the application that's remained is a powerful tool and an interesting thing to look at. There's a whole field of co-properties that we can now look at. If you look at the remainder and you ask yourself, does it have a property? It's also a property on the original set. Notice that there are weak and strong versions. You can either, there exists the compactification with remainder with property P, or the strong one is every compactification, every remainder of compactification has P. In our case, it turned out for Menger, they were the same thing, but that's not going to be true in general. Just be aware of that. This Menger property, when I went to talk with Andrea and Lubomir, this was more or less the first time I'd really heard about it. But as soon as I did hear about it, then it started popping up everywhere. There was work by Alricci and Frank Paul, things to do with the B-space problem, and they're all connected with this Menger property. Seems like a good thing to know about, and the constructions. Games are fun, and I have three questions that you should immediately rush off and solve if you're post-doc. Thank you very much.
Are there any questions?
So for the co-property of being co-Gordon,
yeah.
and that being the same as consonants, is that a weak coat property or strong coat property or both?
Both.
So it's equivalent in this case?
Yes, it is.
Other questions?
Just a general one. The K of X, if it's not matrizable, X is not matrizable, is it the Viatoris topology on the compact sets?
So K of X is matrizable if and only if X is matrizable.
Yeah, but, okay, if X is not matrizable, mm-hmm. what topology do you put on the K of X?
Oh, it's the Viatoris topology.
Okay, that's what I put.
Yeah, thank you.
Any other questions?